Good morning and welcome to our worship. Our worship this morning is led by Mr. Roger Gibson, who recorded the service early on Thursday before the sad announcement of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II's death. We hold King Charles III and all the royal family in our thoughts and in our prayers. As we come to worship, let us pray. Creator God, we give thanks for the life of Her Most Gracious Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II. We honour her life of service, built on a firm foundation of faith and an exemplary commitment to duty. Comfort those who mourn and bring peace to those in distress. We offer our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. On behalf of the Methodist Church here in Bishop Auckland, and on those who are part of our Methodist family and circuit, we offer our continued prayers. Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II was faithful in worship, and so we will continue to worship even in these sad times. May God be with you and with all who mourn in these days. I hand over to Roger to lead us, as I say, in a pre-recorded service.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Bishop Auckland Methodist Church and to our service this morning. I offer you the warmest of welcomes. My name is Roger Gibson, and I'm normally based at Woodhouse Close Church, and it's a privilege and honour to be able to lead worship this morning. Our opening prayers. As we gather for worship, let us spend just a moment in quiet, stilling our hearts, remembering why we are here. May the Lord be with us in our singing, the prayers we offer, and our understanding. May our thoughts be on others rather than self, and our hearts stirred to service as we leave this place.
Amen. Amen.
We sing, O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And adore him, the Lord is his name. Let us just continue in our prayers as we gather in the presence of God. Let us remember that we gather as the children of God, forgiven and accepted, meeting in this sacred place. We gather as brother and sister, family together, meeting in our Father's house. Lord, we gather as your body, blessing each other, the community of Christ. A prayer of adoration. Son of God, you love each one of us, as if there were just one of us. Some have striven hard to obey your commands. Some have found their way after a journey that was long. Some were lost. Some have drifted here unsure of the path they trod. Some are simply here because of your mercy and grace. Son of God, you love each one of us as if there were just one of us. How can we not sing your praises for all that you have done. Amen. Amen. And a prayer of thanksgiving. Gracious Father, loving unconditionally, whose heart overflows with forgiveness, this is our offering of praise. Gracious Son, giving sacrificially, whose body bled for our salvation, this is our offering of praise. Gracious Spirit, flowing eternally, whose breath revives our faith and soul, this is our offering of praise. Amen. We're now going to read one of the psalms set for today, and it is Psalm 14. And we'll do it, there is a response if you can join in. This is Psalm 14. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt, their deeds are vile. There is no one who does good.
The Lord looks down from heaven on all mankind to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God.
All have turned away. All have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one.
Do all these evildoers know nothing?
They devour my people as though eating bread.
They never call on the Lord.
But there they are, overwhelmed with dread, for God is present in the company of the righteous.
You evildoers frustrate the plans of the poor,
but the Lord is their refuge. Oh, that salvation for Israel would come out of Zion. When the Lord restores his people, let Jacob rejoice and Israel be glad.
Amen.
And being conscious of the fact that we are meeting in the presence of God, we have this opportunity now of saying sorry for our misdoings and our misdeeds. We have a time to be able to bring to God those things that are of concern to us in the way that we have behaved, the words we've said, the things that we've done that we should not have done, or the things left undone that we should have done. We just take a moment in silence to lift up to God those times during the past week when we know we have done wrong. The things on your heart that are known only to you and to God. And we say sorry. As we've just read in Psalm 14, fools say in their hearts, there is no God. God, you are beyond our understanding. Your ways are not our ways, and your thoughts are not our thoughts. For you are a sun without a sphere, and a sea without a shore. Father, we acknowledge your greatness and mystery. We acknowledge your existence. And in recognizing that you are responsible for ours, is to acknowledge that we need you. So with the psalmist, we are sorry when we live as if we aren't accountable to you, as if our lives aren't examined by your call to truth, justice, and love. We regret any time that we fail to see you in people who are poor, people who are marginalized,
people who are disadvantaged, people who are weak. In this moment, we confess how our abuse of those around us is an affront to you, the one who is within us. Above all, we confess how our disrespect and naivety, our pride and hypocrisy, our self-sufficiency too often give the impression that we do not seek to do your will, to enjoy your freedom, or to accept your salvation.
By the work of your Spirit in us, we ask you to preserve us from that folly which says there is no God, and rather to look to you to deliver us and restore our fortunes, that we might rejoice and be glad. Lord, we would follow you wherever you might lead.
Lord, we would follow you.
Forgive us when we stumble and when we stray.
Forgive us when distracted we lose our way.
Be the one to whom we turn, whose hand we hold,
the shepherd who leads us safely to the fold.
Lord, we would follow you wherever you might lead. Lord, we would follow you. An assurance of forgiveness taken from 1 Timothy. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ came into the world to save sinners. Our sins are forgiven for his sake.
Thanks be to God.
And we're going to sing again. We're going to sing 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like worship your holy name. Bless you, Lord. is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Come, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name.
And now we turn to our scripture, and our first reading is from the Old Testament, and it's Exodus 32, verses 7 to 14.
The Lord said to Moses, "Hurry and go back down, because your people, whom you led out of Egypt, have sinned and rejected me. They have already left the way that I commanded them to follow. They have made bull calves out of melted gold and have worshipped it and offered sacrifices to it. They are saying that this is their God who led them out of Egypt. I know how stubborn these people are. Now, don't try to stop me. I am angry with them, and I am going to destroy them. Then I will make you and your descendants into a great nation." But Moses pleaded with the Lord, his God, and said, "Lord, why should you be so angry with your people, whom you rescued from Egypt with great might and power? Why should the Egyptians be able to say that you led your people out of Egypt, planning to kill them in the mountains and destroy them completely? Stop being angry, change your mind, and do not bring this disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember the solemn promise you made to them to give them as many descendants as there are stars in the sky, and to give their descendants all the land that you promised would be theirs possession forever. So the Lord changed his mind and did not bring onto his people the disaster he had threatened." Amen.
And our second reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 to 17.
1 Timothy chapter 1 verses 12 to 17. Gratitude for God's mercy. I give thanks to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me the strength for my work. I thank him for considering me worthy and appointing me to serve him, even though in the past I spoke evil of him and persecuted and insulted him. But God was merciful to me because I did not yet have faith and so did not know what I was doing. And our Lord poured out his abundant grace on me and gave me the faith and love which ours in union with Jesus Christ. This is a true saying, to be completely accepted and believed. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. I am the worst of them. But God was merciful to me in order that Jesus Christ might show his full patience in dealing with me, the worst of sinners, as an example for all those who would later believe in him and receive eternal life. To the eternal King, immortal and invisible, the only God, to him be honour and glory for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. We're going to sing again. We're going to sing a song called Way Out Beyond the Stone-Clad Walls, which probably very few people will have come across before, but the tune is very, very familiar. So Way Out Beyond the Stone-Clad Walls. Fill the fold, but every shepherd holds a place where beasts are safe, are kept and held, are held by duty, love and grace. So our gospel reading is taken from Luke 15. One day when many tax collectors and other outcasts came to listen to Jesus, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law started grumbling. This man welcomes outcasts and even eats with them. So Jesus told them a parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. What does he do? He leaves the other 99 sheep in the pasture and goes looking for the one that got lost until he finds it. When he finds it, he's so happy that he puts it on his shoulders and carries it back home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says to them, I am so happy. I found my lost sheep. Let us celebrate. In the same way, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 respectable people who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman who has 10 silver coins loses one of them. What does she do? She lights a lamp, sweeps her house, looks carefully everywhere until she finds it. When she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says to them, I'm so happy I found the coin I lost. Let us celebrate. In the same way I tell you, the angels of God rejoice over one sinner who repents. This is the word of the Lord. I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What does it mean to be lost? To be perfectly honest, Liz and I did get lost trying to find our gîte in France when we were on holiday a couple of weeks ago. And as I started to prepare this talk, I was also reminded of a particular time when Liz and I got lost for several hours, believe it or not, walking the streets of Rome, trying to find the centre of Rome when we'd been to the Vatican, and we just got lost, and we just couldn't find our way back. I guess there is not one amongst us who at some time has not been lost. Most of us know that panicky feeling of being lost in a crowd or on a journey. Indeed, when I was a small boy, one of my earliest memories, I got lost on South Shields Beach and finished up in the Lost Children's Centre. I don't even know if they have one these days, but I remember that. And it must have been at least 60 plus years ago. And as parents, one of the scariest moments for Liz and I was when we lost our five-year-old daughter in Croydon Shopping Centre on the last and busiest Saturday before Christmas, only to be found eventually on the cosmetics counter in Debenhams. She'd had enough sense to go and tell the shop assistant that she was lost. But having the police to search and look for her, well, that was a daunting experience. From a vivid childhood memory, I can assure you, being lost is bewildering, frightening, and awfully lonely. To be found is an incredible joy. The fear and confusion and loneliness are banished by kindly smile and loving arms. Of course, getting lost physically can be the least of our worries. We get lost in relationships, lost in our careers, lost in our life, lost in our faith. Indeed, some of the ways we get lost have not yet been invented. I'm sure when I sit with my mobile phone in the night time, I am lost to my wife. In the Christian context, we say that those who do not have Christ as Saviour are lost. And as Christians, we tend to use the term in a particular way. We talk about people who may be spiritually lost. In some settings, we might talk about lost souls. We might say that people are lost to their sins or lost without Christ. We say it in such a way because it's biblical, because Jesus said in Matthew 18 that he came to save that which was lost. And for the most part, no one likes to admit that they are lost, whether it's lost driving or lost in life. But for most of us, backs up in a corner, taken away all our human options, given a bad doctor's report, throw our life off the tracks, and we get lost. Being lost, lostness, makes us see our need for being found. Being lost, lostness, brings us to our knees. In this world, lostness, being lost, is only a tragedy away. And then, who can we turn to? Who can find us when we've lost our way? All our scripture readings deal with the issues of being lost in one way or another. In Exodus, the people of God have strayed from the path that God had marked out for them. They've turned their back on God, who has brought them out of bondage in Babylon. In the absence of this Moses, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us." They cast aside a covenant with God to make room for a statue, an idol made out of gold, a golden calf, their God, not a representation of God, their God. They make something of high value to represent something they value highly. If ever there was a people who are lost, then it is the people of Israel. They didn't want a living God. They wanted a mascot to go at their head and to lead them into battle, a God entirely within their power. And of course, God is angered. But Moses reminds God of the promises to the people's ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. and to remember the promise of the land for their heritage. And the speech is successful. Because where God was speaking about destroying this people, afterwards it says, the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. Through the grace of God, that disaster was averted. In the epistle reading, the letter from Paul to his friend Timothy, he's dealing with issues relating to leadership of the church. And Paul acknowledges his past and thanks God for the spiritual wealth of mercy, grace, and love that he has received from Christ Jesus. Like the Israelites in our first reading, Paul, as Saul, had acted in a particular way when he met Christians, persecuting them, ensuring that they were put to death. He writes, I used to be a blasphemer and did all I could to injure and discredit the faith. But Paul was not condemned. Rather, he was saved and put on the right path. And clearly, Paul values his redemption above everything else. I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has given me strength, who judged me faithful enough to call me into his service, even though I used to be a blasphemer. What greater example of someone who was lost and was found? Paul, as Saul, was lost, but through the grace of God, he was found. Now we turn to the two parables in Luke. Lost, found, party. This is a popular preaching outline for the parables of the lost sheep and the lost coin. Lost, found, party. In these parables, Jesus takes us to the heart of his mission and indeed his understanding of his role. These stories are his answer to the Pharisees and the scribes who criticize him for welcoming sinners and eating with them. But Jesus tells them that these celebrations here below are only a faint echo of the greater rejoicing among the angels in heaven. Each of these parables has its own nuance, its own point to make. The first parable, the one about the lost sheep, has a truly missional edge to it. You have 99 sheep in the fold. Each is safe and sound. Then there's that other sheep, the one that's wandered off. Yeah, it's too bad. 100 makes a nice round number, but losing one while keeping safe the other 99, well, that isn't such a bad day's work, is it? But that's not Jesus' take on things. He asks us to consider which shepherd wouldn't leave behind the 99 to pursue the one lost sheep. Think about it for a moment. It seems clear to me that Jesus was never a shepherd. Who in their right mind leaves behind the 99 to fend for themselves so you can go after the one that foolishly wandered away? If you don't stay home and tend the flock, something bad could happen. You could lose the entire flock in the foolish pursuit of the one that is lost. Isn't that the way we often see situations? Isn't that the way we may often see things within our church? Take care of those on the inside. Don't worry about those on the outside. But in Jesus' mind, his calling is to go out and find the lost and restore them to fellowship with God. And by doing this, there will be joy in heaven. This parable really doesn't make any sense unless we look at it from God's perspective. That is, God is inclined to take risks to restore us to a right relationship with him. Perhaps we don't notice the fact that there's no criticism of the wandering sheep, although anyone who's ever gone in search of a stray dog or a stray cat, never mind a wandering sheep in the deep heat, knows how utterly frustrating such a search can be. But this lost sheep isn't labelled foolish, naughty, wicked, perverse. Doesn't seem to lead to the shepherd pulling his hair out. Its lostness is simply stated because the lostness is not the point of the parable. Now, if the first parable doesn't leave you scratching your head, the second one surely will. A woman loses one of her 10 silver coins, and she searches high and low for it. And finally, she finds it. And when she finds it, well, what do you do when you do such things? She decides to have a party to celebrate. And she invites all her friends to have a great time. But why? Why throw the party? Why such joy at finding a lost coin? After all, the party itself would have cost far more than the value of the coin. This is simply a foolish venture. And yet, Jesus holds it up as an example to us. Why? Because being lost, lostness, is only the prelude to being found, to a triumphant homecoming, either borne aloft on the shepherd's shoulders, a celebration among friends. There's no condemnation in these two stories, just the urgency of gathering people to celebrate the good news. I have found my sheep that I have lost. Rejoice with me, I have found the drachma I lost. In both parables, the theme revolves around a compassionate, searching God who desires to restore the lost and celebrates heaven's joy when repentance occurs and that which is lost is found. It is a reminder that to Jesus and to God for that matter, what seems foolish to many is the wisdom of God. And in God's wisdom, it is appropriate to leave behind the 99 sheep and throw a party that costs more than the value of the coin that's lost, because God is concerned about the welfare of the one who is lost. God will go to extremes to restore the sinner to fellowship. So why do some wander? The world in which we live feels a very different place from where we were 12 months ago. Thankfully, vaccines have improved the situation with COVID, so we can return to some sense of normality. Some people remain anxious. In addition, the cost of fuel, food, clothing, heating, everyday items has spiraled out of all recognition, leaving many people unable to make ends meet. And then we have the situation in the Ukraine, which has made the world a very volatile place. And we've all been affected by the suffering we've witnessed via the media. Life is not comfortable for many at this time. And each of us has to live with new uncertainties every day. Nearly every day in the news, we are reminded that as a whole, humanity, us, we, fall short of God's will for us. Glancing at the day's news or reflecting on the pain, disappointment and loss staining of our lives, when we reflect upon the inequalities in life, when we reflect upon the poor, those on the margins of society, those who on a worldwide stage seek autonomy, authority, and seem prepared to risk a fragile world peace to exercise control. When we reflect on a world where everyone seems to want to exercise their rights, but at the same time do all they can to avoid responsibility. It seems quite sensible, understandable, not to believe in a God. For many, it is easier to surrender faith than to believe. When life doesn't go our way, are we not swift to question God's sovereignty, even if we do it privately to ourselves? When equality of opportunity and aspects of social justice seem far from achievable in this lifetime, do we not doubt the Lord's ability? Surely I'm not the only one tempted to doubt his faithfulness when his timing doesn't match my hopes and my wishes and my aspirations. So are we not more like those doubting Israelites than we might want to admit? In such circumstances, it is not easier to be lost. And yet we also know that people of all faiths and none continue to seek to make sense of who they are, to make sense of their lives, because they need to be found. When society dispenses with faith as much as our culture claims to do, the false gods, the equivalents of the golden calf, emerge. Those idolatrous tendencies of wealth, image, shameless pursuit of power, celebrity, the cults of convenience, consumption, leisure. But this is not shocking news anymore. But the important message for each of us is that God sticks with us. God continues to claim us as his own, despite it all. Instead of God's burning wrath mentioned in Exodus, hot against us and consuming us, God's grace will dominate through the repentance that he offers, the forgiveness that he offers. And as Luke 15:10 reminds us, there is joy when even one sinner returns to the fold and repents. So are you lost or found? Many Christians automatically identify with the 99 sheep or the 9 coins. The point of the story then is how we, the found, treat the other, which is lost. If you think about it for a moment, such an approach can encourage division and superiority. And in fact, it may even lead to an increase in those who are lost. If people think within our churches that's how we see life, is it any wonder that lots of people find it difficult to come close to us? The real point of the story is to recognize that we are all the lost. We are all lost and we all need to be found. Even if we've been obedient sheep for decades, we were at one point found by God. And God still seeks us. And when we do something that makes us wander away from others, wander away from God, God will come looking for us. When we fail or hurt someone or say or think or do the wrong thing, God comes looking for us. All the time when we are lost in our worldly ways, God, through Jesus, is actively looking for us to find us and bring us back. Back not to condemnation, but back to mercy and celebration. God, through his Son, encourages this church, any church, to see things his way, to seek out the lost, the poor, and the broken. And the demanding and the feckless and those who cannot believe they are loved or matter. And tell them, show them, that in spite of what the world might say, they are loved, they are precious, they are unique in the eyes and heart of God. God invites his church, you and I, everyone here, to spend our time and love on those who need it. Not on those who will bring the best returns, but to wash the feet, not to strut behind those of rank with trappings of power, but to deal with the poor, the disabled, the imprisoned. In any form of local ministry, most congregations are happy to do that, to demonstrate God's love, to continue what might be seen as an inefficient ministry. Inefficient because we do spend hours with people who may never come to church, who may never really understand why we are there for them with our unconditional love. We, you and I, are the people who willingly spend time with the fools who say in their hearts, and indeed not a few out loud, there is no God. So today, I ask, are we ready to continue to head out on what looks like a foolish adventure called the mission of God? Are we ready to go and look and engage with the lost sheep and find the lost coin? Because when we are successful, there will be massive celebration. And Bishop Auckland Methodists is well known for it. Amen. In response, I have a poem called Lost and Found, which was written by someone who may be known to many of you, Marjorie Dobson. I was lost too, straying away from the path that would lead me to safety, security, family, loving and care. I was the despair of those who cherished me, cradled me, treasured me carefully. But for my pleasure, I took to deserting them, hurting them, turning my back on them. Then, for the lack of conscience, I took my nonsensical way to a life where the power of my will was devoured by temptation, sensation, and self-centered living. I found myself giving no thought to the hurt I brought in the wake of my living for nobody's sake but my own. But I was alone. I was lost too, and finally knew that no one there cared or spared a thought for the one who was wandering, helplessly, hopelessly crying and trying to change the direction, rearrange the distraction and find a way out of the doubt and despair, back to care. One simple touch was almost too much. As a loving arm offered to rescue me from harm, but this was God in odd disguise, opening my eyes to the care that had always been there for me. If I had not been too willful to see, and hearing a loving human voice, I knew I had the choice to turn around and find safe ground, back in the company of the God who had been watching over me. A tremendous poem by Marjorie Dobson. We're going to sing again. We're going to sing number 547 in Song Singing the Faith, Beyond These Walls of Worship.
We keep you at the center, for to you, be transformed by you, will declare you God of all. Beyond these walls of worship, in the times of work and rest, will
take this opportunity to affirm our faith. Lord, you have always given bread for the coming day,
and though I am poor today, I believe.
Lord, you have always given strength for the coming day,
and though I am weak today, I believe.
Lord, you have always given peace for the coming day,
and though of anxious heart today, I believe.
Lord, you have always kept me safe in trials.
And now, tried as I am, today I believe.
Lord, you have always marked the road for the coming day.
And though it may be hidden, today I believe.
Lord, you have always lighted this darkness of mine. And though the night is here, today I believe. Lord, you have always spoken when time was ripe.
And though you will be silent now, today I believe.
And that's thanks to the Northumbria Community Celtic Daily Prayer. We move into our time of prayers and intercessions. So let us pray that, having experienced the love and care of Christ, the Good Shepherd, we may try to be loving and caring towards others. We pray for all the shepherds of the church. That they may faithfully watch over the flock of Christ, showing special care for the lost sheep. We pray for our town, its businesses and its services. For those in charge of the civil affairs, that they may be caring in their jobs. We pray for all parents, that they may create homes where children will know that they are loved. We pray for all schools and colleges as the new academic year begins. We pray for all those who are lost. We pray that we may realize how precious we are as individuals to Christ, and that we may try to be loving towards all those we come in contact with each day. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Just take a moment to think of someone who feels that their life is empty at this time. Someone who's overwhelmed by a sense of their own unworthiness. Someone who's been made to feel useless and now finds it hard to live life to the full. They are lost. Think of someone who's hurting. Someone who is facing a time of bereavement or loss. Someone who is facing loss of employment that has been a source of security. Think of someone known to you who needs to learn that they still matter, even when their family have left home. Think of someone who no longer meets for worship. Someone for whom coming to church was something at the heart of their lives. Someone who feels lost. Perhaps someone who's allowed the demands of home and family, the pressures of work, the use of their leisure, or the taste of financial success, to take the place they once gave to God. And just lift them to the Lord and ask his blessing on them. Think of someone who is facing a time of illness or pain. Someone who's taken good health for granted and is now finding it hard to accept their new situation. Perhaps someone you know trying to come to terms with a terminal illness. And think of those who are longing to give them the love and support they will need. And ask Christ to be with them, to hold them and make them whole. And now think of this church and the work that it undertakes. Look around and think of each member present today and give thanks to God. Think of the initiatives in worship that take place and think how it might be more worthy, more relevant, and more challenging. And ask God's blessing on its future. Think of other churches in this area and the ways we might worship, witness, and serve God together. Ask your blessing on John and Vanessa. Give thanks for David. Give thanks for all those who hold positions within the church and think of all that we share in common. And just ask that the presence of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit be open in our hearts to each other. And finally, think of yourself and all the concerns than all that concerns you. Think of all that you must face in the coming days of this week. Lift up to God your worries, your fears, and your concerns. And may the presence of Christ and the power of the Spirit hold you still. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We join our prayers together by saying the prayer that our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our final song, Restore, O Lord.
Of sovereign power, come shake the earth again, that all may see and come with reverent fear to the living God, whose kingdom shall outlast the years. And in a time, revive the church that bears your name. In your anger, Lord, remember mercy, O living God, whose mercy shall outlast the years. Of sovereign power, come shake the earth again, that all may see and come with reverent fear to the living God, whose kingdom shall outlast the
prepare to go out from church to face the challenges of our existence and of the world, we invoke God's blessing on us. May God bless us, giving the strength to seek justice and to seek the lost. May God bless us, giving the wisdom to take care of every living thing being on earth. May God bless us, giving the love that raises us to new life. In the name of the Father, creator of the whole world, of Jesus Christ, our new covenant, and the Holy Spirit, which opens our eyes and hearts to God, may we go in peace, giving witness to the hope that we receive in Christ. Amen. And we finish by saying together the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Before I knew my Savior.